This Nitro show, I swear to God, may have been the worst wrestling show I've ever seen in my life. And actually, there may be worse to come. I've forgotten. There was a Nitro, like, I don't know, 3 or 4 months ago that I was sure was the worst show I'd ever seen. And then there was this one. It's probably going to be more. It's horrible.
I don't know if I can make it.
And dude, let me tell you something. That Raw show, in some ways, Raw was worse than Nitro. Because Raw was so profoundly boring. But Nitro was not boring. But it was the worst wrestling show I've ever seen in my life. I guess I can't say that because it wasn't boring. I guess we'd have to see the show that we saw tonight for Nitro also boring to actually be the worst professional wrestling show of all time. I can't even conceive of it. It's hard to have a boring show when you have 10,000 segments in one show.
When I loaded up the Nitro on the network, when you're online, there's the bar that shows how far along you are in the show, and there's a little dot at the beginning and end of every match. It was like a machine gun had hit my screen. Just brrr.
It's madness.
There was a time where I wanted to watch all the old Raws, you know, for nostalgia reasons. And so I looked forward to Raw kind of every week until it started getting really bad. And now I find myself looking forward to Nitro the same way.
No.
The same way when you drive on the freeway and you see a horrible accident and you slow down to rubberneck and look.
I understand what
you're
saying.
So you're hoping you see Vince Russo dead, is what you're saying.
Oh, Vinny, that's terrible.
That's what Craig said.
What I'm trying to say is, I can tolerate like the first 30 minutes of Nitro every week. Because no matter how horrible it is, like I can tolerate it for about 30 minutes. This show's 3 hours long.
It sure fucking is.
I mean, dude.
And it feels like twice as long. All right, let's begin the worst goddamn Nitro I've seen this week. Monday Nitro number 216, also November 8th, 1999.
Sid
Bully's a production geek.
Now listen, when you get my cue... No, what? What I said, now listen to me. I said, when you get my cue, you put that tape in. I don't care what director, what producer says to you. You put that tape in. And if you don't, I'll be back. Then you have to deal with me. You got that?
Yes.
Sid comes out for a promo on The Outsiders and says, quote,
The Outsiders! I'm not as dumb as I look!
I figured out why he won worst on promos.
Oh, come on. That line
right there.
You want to battle wits with Sid Vicious, Outsiders? Well, then you lose! You lose that battle! Because you got to remember something. I have a brain of a psychopath!
He said. Then he has moved on to Goldberg. He gave the cue. So this is Sid's plan.
Yeah.
Last week, Sid claimed he had video proof saying Goldberg had submitted in their match at Halloween Havoc.
And he should be the champion.
He should be the champion. So he shows a clip. The clip is Sid's on his knees. Goldberg picks him up by the head. And he's got him by the head. He's about to punch him or whatever. And he turns to the ref and says something. And at this point, Sid says,
I quit!
Yeah.
Into the mic.
In the building.
Yes.
Happened again.
I quit! He said, I quit! He gave up! He's a coward!
At this point, Tony Schiavone, lead play-by-play man, says,
I don't know about that. As we hear the music of the Outsiders. Did that sound like Goldberg points to you on that videotape?
He probably was not paying attention.
At this point, I wrote down, my intelligence is so insulted, if only I knew what was to come.
By the way, they've actually got Bobby in a suit this week.
Bobby's also in a suit.
I mean, it was supposed to be stupid, Vinny. That was the point.
Tony's supposed to be stupid, too?
Well, you know.
So, to recap...
Yeah, please.
Hey, there's a bunch of U.S. champions right
Who
now.
Who is the U.S. champion at this point?
Technically, at this point, it's Brett.
Yeah. Okay.
Brett beat Goldberg.
Okay.
Brett considers that an invalid win.
Yes.
So he thinks Goldberg is champ. Yes. Sid thinks he never lost the belt to Goldberg because Goldberg quit. So Sid thinks he is champ. Hall pinned Sid last week. Hall thinks he is champ.
Right.
That about covers it, I think.
So the Outsiders are out there.
I don't lay down for nobody. Because that ain't the way the clique operates.
Now, granted, Scott's competitive juices got a little out of hand last week. But big man, not one of the outsiders hit you in the bean with that crutch. So before you get your panties in a wad, maybe you need to call out that Canadian hero, Bret Hart, because I think your problem's with him, not us.
Bret comes out.
You guys like to talk about panties. You know what you three guys are? Nothing but three big pussies.
That's what he said. I laughed.
He says,
I said it last week, and I'll say it again right here, right now. Bill Goldberg is the United States heavyweight champion.
He's walking fine this week, by the way. He was on crutches last week. This week he's fine and wrestling and everything.
These wrestlers heal faster than normal men.
I guess so. So Bret and Goldberg hit the ring. The outsiders vanish. They beat up Sid. This is still going. This is all one segment.
Yep.
How about a match where only you or I can decide the fate? How about an I Quit match? You got the balls, brother.
I got the balls. You got the balls.
You want to play games?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
You want to play games with me?
Yeah.
I got a game for you. How about a little game of hide and go seek? You hide, I seek, and then destroy.
Somehow he pulled that off.
He's Goldberg.
I don't know how.
He's Goldberg.
That was the opening segment. It went for fucking ever. I'm pretty sure it was the longest segment in the history of Vince Russo Nitros.
It may have been,
because
actually,
every segment after this was
2 minutes tops.
30 seconds.
Often less than that. They show the brackets very quickly. Mike Tenay interviews Sting.
Well, you know something, Mike? The footage doesn't lie. I saw the game Luger was playing last week. It made me want to puke. That good old buddy, that good old pal of mine, has got a lot of splaining to do, Lucy. You know what I'm talking about? If it takes his bat to beat it out of him tonight, then that's exactly what I'll do. And as far as Goldberg goes, well, tonight is going to be a lot different than Halloween Havoc was. I got something to prove. It's showtime, folks.
Lex and Elizabeth sneak into the building. Lex is in disguise. He's got his hoodie pulled low. He's got sunglasses on. Earlier today, Kimberly Page is shown arriving at the building.
Stop right there.
I wish I could.
I was so furious on this fucking show over this storyline.
It's awful.
So, last week, for those of you that don't remember, David Flair is walking through a parking garage, and he gets run the fuck over by a car.
Yeah.
Kimberly Page got in a car, and she tried to kill David Flair.
Yes.
She tried to run him down and end his life in a vehicle.
Mm-hmm. And then got out of the car so we could all see it was her driving it.
Yep. Yes. He flips over the hood. He goes flying. I thought the guy was dead.
Mm-hmm.
Kimberly's driving. She shows no remorse.
No.
This was premeditated.
Sure.
Okay. This week, this woman shows up and says, Doug, I need your help. This lunatic David Flair has been calling me all week.
Probably trying to exchange insurance information.
Please, Craig. She ran him over in a fucking car. Mm-hmm. He called her a few times.
Mm-hmm.
Doug Dillinger takes one look at her breasts.
Yes.
Says, we need extra security for Kimberly here tonight. And the show goes on. She is now a victim.
Yeah.
Being stalked by, like, I don't want to jump forward here, okay? But who is the babyface and who's the heel here?
Dude, there are no babyfaces on the show.
It's not even Shades of Grey.
No, everyone sucks.
She tried to kill him. Now he's going after her, but she's sympathetic.
I guess.
And then later she sets him up, and now she's, like, devilish.
I guess.
Sure.
I don't know.
Who writes this shit?
An idiot.
This
Vince
is
Russo.
A known idiot. By the way, Dillinger says, I'll get you security, and then 3 hours later, there's 7,000 security guys in the show. None of them go to Kimberly.
Right. That's the first job I'd volunteer for.
Apparently, they were busy with Nash and Hall. They needed security.
The outsiders say,
I don't know why.
The outsiders say they need security, too. Nash says, I got my manager's license. He starts to read it, and they cut away. Oh, this filthy animals promo.
These catchphrases.
Yo, let me speak on this. Orale! Arriba la raza! We're loud, we're loud, we're the filthy animals. As you can see, we got our pedigree back in the house. Yo, Torrie, you like this fuzzy hat? Feel, that's enough. Revolution, make no bones about it. Us animals, we in heat. Orale!
He puts in like fake buck teeth.
Yes.
He's walking around the background with fake buck teeth sticking out.
Yeah.
Why?
I don't know.
Ray, for the second week in a row, threatens to hump you like the dogs that we are.
This time he did say that we are.
Yes. He did say that.
He's not a dog humper. Now he's a humping dog.
So, well, anyway.
Dogs will hump anything, Vinny. There is a big difference.
That is true. That is true. So, out come their opponents, the Revolution. There's Asia in her red bondage gear. And Dean Malenko, who looks more like a dorky dad every single week.
Especially standing next to her.
Yeah, exactly. She looks like a supervillain. She looks like Dr. Doom with boobs.
Yes.
And a prettier face. And Dean's out there in his waist-high jeans and his plaid button-up shirt. My shirt's much cooler than Dean's, if you're wondering. It's tucked into his jeans. He looks like a man who would use the word nifty a lot, non-ironically.
Sure.
So this leads to being Dean and Asia versus Ray and Torrie tonight.
Yeah, that's what Dean wants. And Ray accepts.
Yeah.
By the way, at the moment, Torrie is out there.
Oh my gosh.
In a very, very tight gown and high heels. That's what she's wearing for this particular segment.
This was a tight skirt and a bikini top.
Her open back too.
Oh my goodness. Yeah.
Second round world championship tournament match, Screamin' Norman Smiley versus Kidman. Norman comes out in a full hockey uniform, including pads.
Mm-hmm.
He should have had skates on and kicked him in the face.
And he had the helmet on as well.
Had the helmet on at first, got knocked out. So he gets knocked outside. Bryan Knobs is on commentary, attacks him with a stick.
There was lots of ass slapping in this match.
A lot of Norman's lewd dance, as you always called it back in the day.
Yeah, the big wiggle. I refuse to refer to it as the big wiggle, but now I do. By the way, in the middle of this match, randomly, the announcers alert us, tonight, there will be a Texas Tornado ladder match with a special guest referee.
Yes.
What?
For the U.S. title.
All right.
For the U.S. title.
Okay.
That's a big deal.
That'll solve that problem.
Mm-hmm.
So Knobs destroys the hockey stick over Norman. Kidman throws Norman in the ring and pins him at 212.
Wow. That's a long one.
And then it's to the back.
Of course it is. Four, I swear to God, four different five-second segments in a row.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sting is hunting for Lex. Lex is hiding in the laundry room. David Flair arrives with the crowbar. Nash puts on the Grand Wizard of Wrestling hat.
Yes.
For those of you who are not historians, frankly, I don't know very much about him, but Grand Wizard in this case is not a clan reference. There was a Grand Wizard of Wrestling in New York in the late 70s, Ernie Roth.
Early 70s, yes.
Very much not a clan member.
Yes.
So this is who Nash is imitating here. I've never actually seen, I don't think, a Grand Wizard promo. Was his voice in real life as annoying as Nash's voice?
No, Nash is doing a parody of a parody.
Okay. So as he puts the wizard hat on, Scott Hall says,
oh man, turn into a cartoon character.
No kidding. A SWAT team casually passes by down the hallway, and Hall goes to harass them. Sting comes out for a promo. He demands Lex. He says,
Lex Luger! Lexi, Lexi! Total package, whatever it is that you call yourself now, I'm giving you exactly 30 seconds to show up right here. We can do this nice and easy, or we can do this nice and rough.
So Sting and Lex are apparently much closer than I ever realized.
Wow.
Liz comes out instead. So remember the big C on the ramp that everyone trips over?
Yes.
They said, well, we'll cover it in carpet, and no one will trip on it anymore.
I had a theory on that. I think the girls, they wear those stiletto heels.
Probably.
They get stuck in there, so they just throw a carpet over it.
Well, Liz still tripped anyway.
That's true.
So at first I thought the C was gone, but it's back later. They just put it out for here. So Liz almost falls on her ass coming out.
She says,
Sting, the package wanted me to come out here and apologize to you. You know, this whole thing has been blown way out of proportion. He treasures your friendship and would never do anything to jeopardize that. From the bottom of his heart, he's really sorry.
Sting starts to molest her.
Wow. He puts his arm around her and manhandles her.
Yeah, and she's looking very uncomfortable.
Yes, he's...
This would not fly in 2018.
No, this is inappropriate behavior for sure.
It sure was.
Yeah.
Well, Liz, I've tried unsuccessfully tonight to get the total package out here, so I'm not asking you, I'm telling you, you need to call him out here immediately.
She doesn't, but Lex comes out anyway. Lex takes forever.
Stinger!
No.
As I always have, for 14 years, I come in friendship. Nothing has ever been able to get between us. We can work this thing out, Stinger.
Lex wants a hug. Eventually, Sting handles him back to the corner and says, quote,
if you ever swerve me again, I'll get ya. I'm gonna rip your throat out next time.
You should have used that line more often. That could have been on a shirt.
I'm gonna get you.
I'll get you.
I'm pretty sure he does, actually. Yeah. As these shows go on,
I remember this vividly, and it could not have just been from this promo.
Yeah.
There's no way I could remember anything from the show without copious notes.
Kimberly walks into her locker room, the hottest woman in the world
she ever.
And then some moron 2 seconds in turns the lights out. It's David, of course. I think David was a little bit better of an actor than Linda McMahon. But
no. No.
Kimberly. Do you remember me? Don't worry. You won't feel a thing.
He threatened either her life or her vagina.
Certainly her safety.
Let me just. Yes, Craig?
You won't feel a thing, and you thought he was referencing her vagina?
Or her life.
It's not Ric Flair.
Or both.
You won't feel a thing?
Hey,
again,
listen.
It's not Ric Flair.
Yeah, it's David.
So he's... Never mind. Go ahead.
Now, listen.
Why do you think he lives in the woods now?
They do this segment where the lights go out. David Flair threatens her.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Says, you won't feel a thing.
She screams.
She screams. They cut back to Tony Schiavone and he goes...
Did that sound like David Flair to you?
Sounded like David Flair to me, Mr. Schiavone.
Oh, my goodness. Fans... This can of surge, and on the back, Goldberg.
He looks at the
monitor.
You think
I'm kidding?
No, I don't.
He blew this off like it was just the dumbest thing he'd ever seen.
Kimberly's got herself into a mess tonight. something like that.
Yeah.
Get this new surge with Goldberg on it. Surge!
And Bobby's so concerned, he steals the surge.
Mm-hmm.
They're doing surge comedy. She's about to have a crowbar. God only knows what he's going to do with it.
She won't feel it, though.
Second round tournament match, Chris Benoit versus Medusa.
Excuse me. Chris Benoit versus Medusa.
Yeah.
I had so many... First off, Chris Benoit versus any woman.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Very, very difficult to watch.
No good. Sure. No good.
With that said, the way he did the match, he barely laid a hand on her.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
He hit her with one chop after a while.
Yeah. Yes.
He out-wrestles her for a little while. He begs her to just lay down. She finally boots him, starts kicking the hell out of him, mm-hmm. gives him a Hurricane Rana, gives her a chop. She goes down. He's begging the ref to just stop the match. He doesn't want to lay another hand on her.
Mm-hmm.
This idiot Evan Courageous runs down. Evan Courageous says, ref, you've got to stop this match. The ref says, get the hell out of here. Evan Courageous and the referee get in a fist fight.
Yes, they come to blows.
All right, to me, this is a disqualification.
I would think sure. so.
Not to this ref.
No.
They get a goddamn
fight. To be fair,
fight.
He was winning.
Jeff Jarrett.
The ref beat up Evan.
Jeff Jarrett runs down. As soon as Jeff lays a hand on Benoit, well, that's a DQ.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Don't even.
Oh, we'll be here all night. No. I must talk about this. They're having a world title tournament with what they claimed was 32 men. I got to go back just a little while to explain this to everybody. They wanted Medusa to do a bra and panties match or a evening gown match or some stupid match. She refused.
Mm-hmm.
So they punished her by putting her in the tournament with Ming.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
Evan Courageous ran out. Clearly, Evan and Medusa have something going on.
Sure.
So to punish her further, they put her back in the tournament against Evan Courageous. She beats Evan via lip lock. Then they put her in the tournament with Chris Benoit, clearly still attempting to punish her.
Mm-hmm.
Well, then the chosen one, Jeff Jarrett, comes out and he screws her out of the tournament.
That's a detail I missed.
The chosen one of the writers.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Screwed her out of the tournament that the writers had spent weeks putting her back in to screw her.
Maybe they were satisfied with the beating she took here. The one chop.
The one chop.
This is the dumbest thing. Like, I remembered that Medusa, like, was somehow put in the tournament twice. I didn't even remember all of these little details. It's 1,000 times dumber than I thought.
Yes. It constantly violates, the show constantly violates its own internal logic. It contradicts itself over and over again.
Not to mention, she was put in with Meng, Evan, and Benoit as punishment. Why would they send Jeff Jarrett out to save her from Benoit?
I don't know. Bryan, I don't have an answer.
It makes no sense.
I hate this show.
It's terrible.
I hate it.
It's terrible.
Like I said before, this is not the WWF, and we do not hit women here.
Run for your life, Jarrett!
Let me spell it out to you. I just screwed you out of the tournament.
Chavo Guerrero meets with Vince Russo, whose new gimmick, or he tells him his new gimmick is going to be to go sell Amway. So this is now we reach the era, I think this is the first time, really, where it became a regular thing, where the promoters and writers of the show became the stars and the wrestlers became geeks.
No shit.
Yep.
Yeah. Mayhem match of the week is the Cat blowing out his knee last week and losing to Lash LaRue.
Yeah.
Hacksaw Duggan is now cleaning toilets. He cuts a promo on the toilet.
I can't believe it. Clean the power to these toilets. Clean the power to these toilets. Well, I'll clean the power to these toilets. I'll clean the best pink toilet in the country right here, this toilet.
It was kind of funny, I guess. Rick Steiner versus Disco Inferno for the TV title. Tony Mama Luke comes out with a bucket.
Now Tony Marinara.
Vince Russo is Italian, right? I assume.
I guess.
Even his own ethnicity, everyone has to be a stereotype. Tony Marinara?
Yeah.
I'm surprised they make him Chavo Burrito in the last segment.
Well, he's about to be Lieutenant Loco.
I guess so.
Oh my gosh, that's coming up.
So, dude, there's a lot coming up in a year.
Yes.
So it's impossible to believe.
Tony Marinara says he wants his money from Disco. I've known him since me and Glenn were kids, he says.
Yep. This is where I wrote, the show is dying a brutal death. Steiner hits him with a bucket of cement.
What?
Yeah. So there was a bucket of cement out there.
A bucket full of cement.
Yes, because Tony Marinara is going to put the cement boots on Disco Inferno cement and toss him into the lake.
Right.
Okay, so he's got the bucket of cement.
Right.
Because I guess he's going to do it here on Nitro.
I suppose.
He hits him with the bucket instead. Steiner German's the guy and pins him.
Right.
In like 10 seconds. Mm-hmm. 30? How long?
I didn't go a minute. I didn't time this one.
Horrible.
This is the best guy they could get for a stereotypic Italian guy who was a mobster.
Yeah.
He's like $1.05.
Yes.
We're going to put you in some cement shoes, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah. Sting and Goldberg warm up in silence was the best part of the show. Nash is going over his Grand Wizard costume. He's got powder to throw in the eyes, Monsel powder, I assume. Mm-hmm. He's got chloroform. He's got brass knuckles.
Kev, been thinking about last week, you know, with Sid. I feel bad about him. You think we should try and make up with him?
They go to do that. The Nitro Girl Hopefuls.
Oh, my God.
Are in the ring. The vote is tonight, so they all do a dance, and then AC Jazz arrives.
BG, it's time to get these girls out of the ring. I mean, get them out of the ring. Out! Out of the ring! Tired of it. You're Nitro Girl wannabes. I'm sick of this. We are the Nitro Girls. We are the Nitro Girls. You are skanks. I said skanks.
She had a line here that I watched about 15 times trying to figure it out. I swear to God, I understood Meng better in that promo you played 2 weeks ago. Something she said about the household department at Kmart.
The last time I saw so many you little iron words. It was the household department at Kmart. That's what I'm talking about.
I don't know what.
AC Jazz comes out. This is what happens in this segment here. AC's yelling at the girl. She tells him to get out of the ring. Spice comes out. They start arguing.
He's out of control.
AC, what is wrong with you, girl? I don't know what has gotten into you. Those girls are not skanks. They have just as much right to be in this ring as you and I do. They are not, girl.
What are you, little Mary Poppins? Woo, you're here to save the day, girl. Why don't you get your little umbrella and fly away like the witch bitch that you are?
Which makes television.
What, that's it? She's on. It's on, AC, because...
Which makes television. They have, and I am not making this up, the worst fight I've ever seen in my life.
So yeah. Horrible.
Am I wrong?
No.
Like, I am not exaggerating here. It was the worst fight I've ever seen in my life. They're two legit dancers. They're not fighters.
No.
They're not wrestlers.
No.
So they start, like, grabbing each other, and every time they fall down, they, like, fall down and land in a pose and then get back up. I swear to God. This was the worst fight I've ever seen. Ever in my life.
It was so ungodly terrible.
Thunder is booing.
The other girls come out to break it up. At this point, I wrote, high on the list of worst things I've ever seen in a wrestling ring.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I'm talking Jenna Maraska had some training.
Yeah.
Sharmell.
Their highlights were better than this.
The other Survivor girls. Rebel. This was worse than any of those.
And it wasn't just a fight. AC Jazz is the worst promo ever.
I don't know if I can go quite that far. The fight was much worse than the promo. The
promo was not emotionally charged.
Kimberly, okay, back to this shit. Jesus Christ. All right, so David Flair is stalking Kimberly backstage with a crowbar so that he can beat her to death, right?
By the way, David is limping. Selling the thrashing from the car.
From the car. Week.
But that's it.
All right.
That's it. And his eyes are bugged out. It looks like he hasn't slept. His hair's all disheveled. Anyway, go ahead, Vinny.
So we're in a hallway. Down the other end of the hallway is David Flair with his murder stick. We see the camera, and then to the right of the camera, we see Kimberly. We see her hiding behind a pole. David can't see her. But he can see the fucking camera. What does he think the camera's shooting? What's wrong with this idiot? She drops something metal and makes a noise.
She's trying to hide from David.
Yes.
While holding a pipe.
Yeah, she's going to hit him with a pipe.
And she stands there unmoving and then just drops the pipe.
Ka-dang!
And he goes, oh!
Butterfinger.
And she goes, oh! And she goes to run away.
I can't
believe
how bad the show
is. She's doing this in a tiny, tiny skirt.
Of course, yes.
And stockings and high heels.
Yes.
Hey, you know what else she's doing this in? A crowded arena full of thousands of people.
Yep.
And she's hiding the hallways alone. Go out in the building where there's people to hide with.
And then,
this
once
the
word, again...
Like, in the world of stupid victims in horror movies, she's the dumbest.
And then...
Also the hottest.
Yeah.
David lurches after her, and they cut back to the announcers, and Tony is howling at all of this. Mm-hmm. It gets funnier to him by the moment. Man, she's in hot water.
He's gonna fucking kill her.
Dude.
That's not a quote, but... Okay, at this point, Bryan... You watched the show a few hours before I did. So you earlier had tweeted something along the lines of, this is one of the very worst TV shows I've ever seen. At this point, I retweeted that and said, he's not wrong. Right after I tweeted that, 7 debuts.
Yes.
The show got much worse. So here's the thing. We have for like a month seen Dustin Rhodes as Uncle Fester doing some weird child molester gimmick or some creeper peeking in windows and... Pied Piper getting kissed, following whatever. The whole thing has been a setup so he can come out, levitate down to the ring on cables.
No, Vinny. May I correct you for a moment? The 7 thing started
before
Russo came in.
Yep.
So I believe what happened is Russo did not like 7.
Okay.
And so I guess as to make good, Dustin got to do his character one time and then do a shoot promo. But he didn't want to do it.
If they were going to kill the gimmick, why did they go into all the detail of this elaborate entrance and the music and the
So we could
cut
a shoot promo.
Okay.
Okay, now, the setup is terrible. The payoff to this angle has been terrible. Dustin's promo was good. I will say that. I'm a fair man. Yeah. Dustin's delivery here was very good.
But everybody in here to take a good, long look at this crap I'm in.
What?
I left the World Wrestling Federation for gimmicks like this. All of you don't know I was Gold Dust, and Gold Dust sucked. Gold Dust nearly ruined my wrestling career. You see, I wanted to come back to WCW because this is home for me, and I wanted to be just me, because that's what I can do, just be me. But the powers that be came to me and they said, Dustin, you know, Dustin sucks. Dustin is boring. So I here now, I stand before you, and oh, my new name is Seven, by the way, so. They've dressed me up like Uncle Fester to play trick or treat all year long. Powers that be, what you can do is take Gold Dust and shove it up your ass. You can take this silly looking thing, Seven, and shove it up your ass. And you both can kiss my ass. Now last week, my father called me Dusty Rhodes. And it seems that he's no longer with this company. After 25 years of building everything that you see right here and right now, they kicked him to the curb like he was a piece of shit.
Yes.
Which also made her.
1999, yes. Everyone. Not on TNT, not South Park on Comedy Central.
In
prime time.
I believe that Dusty wanted Russo's job and they told him no, and so he quit.
Probably.
Good.
Well, powers that be, that hadn't cut the mustard, and now you got to deal with me because you disrespected my father. You disrespected the Rhodes name, and you disrespected me for the last damn time. You understand? So from this moment on tonight and to the end of your lives, I am going to make your life a miserable hell. I'm going to make WCW a miserable hell and TNT too. So boys, I know you're back there staring, your little fat faces in the monitor looking at me. You know one thing. Tonight and forevermore, you will never, ever forget the name of Dustin Rhodes.
This was a very good promo by Dustin Rhodes.
Sure.
Sting walked for 3 seconds.
I wrote Sting running.
Maybe running.
Maybe I was fast forwarding.
David Flair found a dark room where Kimberly Page was hiding behind a copy machine. Somehow she got out. I don't know how.
Yeah.
The outsiders go to meet with Sid. The total package says he has an idea. I'm so mad. We're not even halfway through this goddamn show.
Yeah, we have to be.
Yeah, we're close.
Sting versus Goldberg. Sting versus Goldberg as a random match in a terrible Nitro.
You know what's funny is when Sting came out to wrestle Goldberg, I thought, you know, there are always these matches I seem to remember were like really great. Like there was a great Goldberg-Sting match. Can't possibly be this one. Was it ever not this one? Let me tell you what happened in this match. Within like 10 seconds, Sting puts Goldberg in a sleeper. Like immediately.
Yeah.
Okay, there's one thing Goldberg can't do.
Sell.
Yeah. So let's start the match by putting this fucking guy in a sleeper. So he's in a sleeper for like 5 minutes while we're waiting for Liz and Luger to come out. The ref takes a fucking bump.
At this point, as the ref goes down, Tony Schiavone says, Mickey J received a glancing blow.
A glancing blow.
He's dead.
Yes. So they drag him around the ring. They spray mace in Sting's face.
On purpose.
Goldberg does not give a shit. He spears and jackhammers Sting. He gets the pin. This was wretched. Now, what's funny is Goldberg hit one spear and the place went nuts.
Yeah.
This is so easy.
Yeah. You have Goldberg spear dudes.
Nothing is easier than Goldberg.
Yes.
Yep.
The very first thing Russo did was pin Goldberg.
Of course.
Now we have a match that's all Goldberg in a sleeper. And one fucking spear after someone sprayed shit in the other guy's face.
Mm-hmm.
This is the worst show I've ever seen.
This went 2:13, by the way.
Sid is talking to the outsiders. Rick Steiner shows up. He's mad at Sid. Lord knows why.
I have no idea why. I wrote here, what's he talking about? No one knows. Something on Thunder, I'm sure they didn't bother to tell us about.
They were partners.
Yeah, yes, they were partners, Craig.
Yeah.
Why are they mad now?
I don't know.
That's our point.
Thank you.
I'm sorry.
Lex and Liz laugh at Hacksaw for being a janitor, and then Lex has a bright idea. Like, the light bulb pops up over his head, and he steals Hacksaw's, like, a slippery when wet cone.
He's an idiot.
Both of them.
I got a few things to say here. I don't want
to
waste too much time.
Have to be more specific.
First off, you want to know why WCW died? They're paying Hacksaw Jim Duggan his salary to be the fucking janitor.
Yeah.
That's number one. Number two, so Luger's idea is he's going to pretend to slip and fall and sell that he's got a gimmick leg. So why are you getting rid of the slippery when wet sign, you fucking moron?
Well,
you should leave it right next to yourself when you fall down.
He did.
He did.
But he put it somewhere else?
Yes. He had to make another wet spot instead of using the one Hacksaw made. And yes, I said that on purpose. Mm-hmm. In 5 seconds, Kimberly found a guy in security for help. It was David. She ran away. Mike Tenay interviews Vampiro and the Misfits. Vampiro was the calmest, most mellow, level-headed, laid-back, angry young punk rebel you ever saw.
You know, Mike, this ain't no debut. Being a misfit, basically meaning you're an outcast from society. This is a lifestyle. This is something that happens to you when you go against the grain. Kids picking you on you in school, parents yelling at you, just being different from everybody else. This is a lifestyle. You know, and as far as Buff Bagwell's concerned, you better pay attention because Berlin found out last week that evil's got a place in WCW. Nightmare's just beginning. Here we are, knocking on the door.
Second round, World Championship Tournament match, Buff Bagwell versus Vampiro. So the Misfits jump Buff, like five of them. Five big dudes all jump Bagwell on the island, beat him up, which you can do and not get punished.
Yeah, the ref just rings the bell.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. He'll be all right.
The announcers are talking about David and Kimberly.
He is playing some serious mind games with the girl. He's freaking her out.
You know, when she came up behind him, if he wanted her, he could have had her there.
Yeah, he could grab her right there.
But you know, some mind games are worse than physically being abused.
Really? I was unaware of that fact.
I would rather have mind games played on me than be beaten with a crowbar. Buff fights off the Misfits. The ref gets bumped because, of course, he does. Berlin hits Vampiro with a chain. Why? Are Berlin and Vampiro feuding now?
I don't know, but they could hang out together. They're wearing the exact same outfits.
That's true. Exactly. You should fit in with them. Buff hits a blockbuster for the win at 1:21. Creative Control attacks Berlin, who is beaten up, even though he has a bodyguard, because the bodyguard is not there guarding his body. He's beating up Bagwell or whatever. Lex is down on the floor next to his cone. He says, "Oh, I've blown out my knee bad.
I need some medication or something.
I need some medication for his first bot. Can I get some gimmicks? I need some gizmos.
Bring Vicodin."
So they go to break. They come
back.
This
is one of those things where, like, Luger's hilarious.
He really is.
It's fucking terrible.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Like, this is possible. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
Like, the last thing Luger needs to be doing is this bullshit.
Yes.
So after the break, he's on a stretcher and complaining about his knee.
Asking for Vicodin. Meds.
Okay. Bret Hart versus Saturn.
I was looking forward to this.
Bret Hart versus Perry. Hey, the wrestling they did was pretty... It had some downs. They were kind of going through the motions, but Bret Hart going through the motions.
I wonder why.
Yes. Exactly.
Let's put some fucking work into this tournament.
I don't blame you, but Bret Hart going through the motions is still awesome.
Yes.
So Shane Douglas is on commentary with Saturn.
He was the highlight of this damn show. I haven't always been the biggest Shane Douglas fan, but over the last month watching him on Nitro, I totally turned the corner on this guy.
Shane as a talker is awesome.
He was such a fucking great commentator. Mostly because his guy was having bad things happen to him. Mm-hmm. And he's just screaming at the top of his lungs. No! He's screaming.
Get up, Perry!
I was like, if this guy did commentary every Monday on Raw,
yeah,
I'd love this show.
Yes. Now, in the middle of this, they announced that Shane and everyone else in the Revolution is banned from ringside. And he's outraged. He's appalled. And then he stays there.
Well, he's doing commentary.
Why are they telling you he's banned from ringside?
Commentaries at ringside.
It's different, I guess.
I don't know what's happening.
Do you ever?
No. Asia takes the ref. Shane hits Bret with his cast. Saturn hits the DVD. Bret kicks out. I thought Saturn was going to pin Bret Hart.
I swear to God, I did too.
Credit to them. I thought Perry Saturn was going to pin Bret Hart in the World Championship Tournament match. So Dean attacks Brett. Benoit attacks Dean. Saturn dives in them both. Saturn gets back to the ring. He tries a sunset flip. Brett turns into a sharpshooter for the win at 5 minutes and 2 seconds.
Wow.
Fun wrestling.
Finally something of value on the show.
Fun wrestling.
And Shane Douglas.
A more or less clean finish. And the right man won. And the crowd liked it.
Yes.
This is the best match in weeks on best thing in the last 2 weeks on Nitro. And then it's to the back.
Boy, was it ever to the back.
Kimberly says, I need to talk to Vince Russo. Creative Control says, no.
Yeah.
In a segment that has not aged well, Kevin Nash tries to do Karnak the Magnificent from the Johnny Carson show.
Yes. In the 70s.
When did Carson retire? Leto had already been on. For like 5 years on the Tonight Show. So this is old when they did it.
Yes.
It's much older now.
Yes.
So the joke is, what is 316? It's the number of times The Undertaker has worked a pay-per-view main event with Austin. Hall says, is that true? And I says, well, yeah, where you been?
Hall is a really funny guy.
Hall says, I was drunk for a year.
I was drunk for a year.
He was.
That's not an exaggeration.
I know.
Lex tells Elizabeth his knee hurts. She says she'll get some ice, and then she just stands there. Booker T promo. Stevie Ray got suspended. I don't know why. I don't care. Booker T is mad at the powers that be. He's mad at Jarrett. Outcome, he challenges them to a Harlem street fight for right now.
He's actually totally confused because he's mad that Creative Control suspended his brother. Creative Control are the two bodyguards.
Okay.
They're not suspending anybody.
We're like 2/3 of the way through the show now, by the way. So it turns into Booker T versus Creative Control and Jarrett, I guess, in a Harlem street fight.
Nah, Jarrett's on commentary. Although he hit the ring immediately.
Yeah.
But it's a street fight, so he can.
So there's three of them beating him up. People were into Booker. Midnight makes her debut.
Yes.
Yet another large, muscular woman.
Yes.
China was successful. We must find 18 of them now. She hits the ring. In her debut, she hits the ring. In 3 seconds, Jarrett lays her out with a guitar.
Yep.
She got waffled.
Right in the face.
Yeah. At this point, in a Harlem street fight, the referee called for the bell for a disqualification.
Yeah.
Did you notice that when the guitar...
Well, Harlem street fights are different, Vinny. Different rule set.
They're street fights, but there's a very strict set of rules we follow.
Yes, you must follow the rules.
We're not animals. We just fight in the streets.
Did you notice when she got hit with the guitar? You know how the guitar has the body and then it has the neck. The neck is the handle.
I'm with you.
So the guitar explodes all around her, but then the neck, the top of it, just bashes her right in the forehead.
I did not notice that.
Oh.
Now, this is not the worst finish in the show. This is not close to the worst finish in the show. The Outsiders meet with a SWAT team. There's some kind of jokes or fucking, I don't know. Mike Tenay tells Lex that he is facing Sid Vicious next. Lex is in a wheelchair with ice in his knee. Says, I cannot compete until I get an MRI.
And the best thing, they somehow found a blanket so he could put over his lap.
He's cold.
Howled.
He states, I have been on the cell phone with my neurosurgeon, or his surgeon. What do we call a knee surgeon? What the fuck?
Orthoscopic surgeon.
I'm so tired.
A neurosurgeon.
Ah, hey, here you go.
Thank you.
Doctor says, no, I cannot compete until I get an MRI. So Tenay says, well, if you don't compete, you'll be out of the tournament. This is a surprise to Lex.
Yes.
A tremendous buffoon.
He says, Liz, do something about this.
Something. You're my manager.
You're my manager.
Lex is funny. Lex makes me laugh.
He does make me laugh.
So it's Dean and Asia versus Rey Mysterio and Torrie Wilson.
Okay, may I? It's Torrie Wilson.
Someday I will say no to that, by the way.
And Rey Mysterio versus Malenko and Asia. All right? Torrie comes out and she is wearing her super tight short gown and her bikini top and high heels.
The same thing.
Yeah.
She hasn't even attempted to put on anything resembling wrestling gear.
No.
She gets in the ring. She pretends like she's going to take her skirt off. Ray goes, no, 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 no. Like, I guess he's okay.
Humping anything?
Wait a second. Like
the doggy is.
Why wouldn't he let her take her thing off? But that's not the biggest issue here, Vinny. He goes, you're fine wearing that. You're not fine wearing that. He didn't even tell her to take her high heels off.
No. Right.
So.
I assume he was just going to wrestle the whole match by himself anyway.
No! So she goes to the corner. Asia comes over and Asia handcuffs her to the turnbuckle.
Yes.
Torrie is trapped in the corner. Then the story of the match is that Ray is now in a handicap situation.
Yes.
He is beaten by both of his opponents, Asia and Dean Malenko. And then the odds are too much for Rey Mysterio. He is put in the clover leaf and he must submit.
Yes.
So apparently what us dumb fuck fans are supposed to think is that if Torrie, in her high heels and gown,
yes,
had not been handcuffed to the corner.
Whole different match.
A different dynamic. It's 2-on-2 now.
Fair fight.
Rey very well could have won.
She would have been there to save him.
Yes, but because she was handcuffed, the odds were too great. This was the dumbest fucking thing.
So let's recap.
I feel like I've said that 10 times on this show.
This is not a long match. It's probably a 3-minute match. I guess it's long by Nitro 99 standards. But the very first thing they did was handcuff Torrie to the post so Rey is all alone. They beat Rey 2-on-1 for 3 minutes. They beat Rey. There's a post-match beating. Finally, the filthy animals come out to clear the ring.
Mm-hmm.
Where the fuck have you been? This faction sucks.
By the way, Asia better with handcuffs than Liz.
Yeah. Just walked up, put them on her. Kimberly finds a hot tub. Asks what she's going to do. Cries. David is in the shower and says something about how it's going to be more than a spanking, and she cries and runs away.
This time it'll be more than a spanking. When was there a spanking?
What's
he talking about?
Don't have any idea.
So this is a tournament match, I think.
Yeah, Sid versus Luger.
Sid Lex is?
Yeah, yeah. All
right.
Yeah, because if Luger doesn't wrestle, he's out of the tournament, you idiot. You just recap that.
That's right. So Lex comes out in a wheelchair, says he's hurt. He'll be able to wrestle next week. He's trying to delay the match. Sting comes out, sends Liz to the back, pushes Lex's chair down to the ring and attacks him. Throws in the ring. Sid stomping Lex. Liz hits the ring to check on Lex. Lex pulls Liz in front of him. Sid gently moves her aside. Tony is now convinced Lex's leg is legit hurt. He's selling the leg and Tony's fooled. Goldberg runs out and spears Sid. Not a DQ. By the way, Sid came out with a SWAT team to protect him from Goldberg. This is important. They just spread aside. They split like the Red Sea, and Goldberg just hit the ring between them and spears Sid.
Yeah. By the way, who's the referee in this match when Goldberg is spearing one of the participants and it's not a DQ?
I'm going to guess Nick Patrick.
Goddamn right. Staring right at him.
Weird.
So then Goldberg spears Lex 2, and Goldberg's music plays as they go to commercial. There is no finish at 2:46.
Yeah, so what happened?
I don't know.
It was a tournament match. Who knows?
I think.
I got to find out.
No,
you tell me what you think.
They said earlier, due to injury, Lex and Sting were already advancing. I don't think this was a tournament match. I think they threatened Lex with the removal of the tournament to get him to go out and wrestle this non-tournament match.
God damn, I think you're right.
Okay.
Who do you wrestle?
Sid. I only just now figured that out. I was totally baffled at the time. Bam Bam Bigelow faced Bryan Knobs.
I'd like to add, by the way, that after that Sid versus Luger match, in all caps I wrote, one of the worst wrestling shows I have ever seen. That's where I came to that conclusion.
That's fair.
And there was more to come.
Bam Bam Bigelow versus Bryan Knobs in a hardcore match.
This finish.
The rules to a hardcore match are you can hit people with shit, and it's falls count anywhere.
That's correct, Vinny.
Falls count anywhere.
Vinny, you are correct.
Anywhere!
Vinny, you are still correct.
So I need to find the old figure fours.
They brawl backstage. They're in the back. They're hitting each other with shit.
Mm-hmm.
2 hours into the show, Kimberly says, wait, I have friends. I have big, scary friends.
Right.
They'll protect me from this geek with a crowbar. She goes up to Bam Bam Bigelow, says, Bam Bam, please, I need your help. Bam Bam is, of course, close with DDP. It only figures he would be close with Kimberly as well.
Sure.
He's going to protect her. Fine.
Wish the announcers would have told me that.
So they're going to leave. And I think, okay. So they're doing no finish in a hardcore match.
Oh, you were wrong.
That's stupid. But on this show, would have fit right in. They actually found a way to make it much worse. Because the referee watches Bam Bam Bigelow walk away and goes, one!
By the way, they're not in the ring. They're in a loading bay.
They're backstage! It doesn't matter
hundreds
where.
Hundreds of yards in the ring.
Right.
And the referee goes, two. And I said, no. No, they can't be doing this. And the ref goes, three. I'll cut to the chase. Everyone. He got to 10. He counted Bam Bam Bigelow out. Bam Bam Bigelow was counted out of anywhere. He's not anywhere. He's nowhere.
Well, my presumption, Vinny, is he went somewhere.
No, somewhere, Bryan. Somewhere would be anywhere.
No, that's somewhere.
Bam Bam is lost between the space-time continuum.
It's false count anywhere. If you're somewhere, you're anywhere. He went nowhere.
There's a lot to be said for
I've never been simultaneously so angry and laughing so hard. He got counted out, Bryan.
He got counted
out of nowhere. He got counted out of false count anywhere. Did I say it was anywhere?
He got counted out of nowhere.
God! These fucking morons! I'm too smart for this show. Do you understand, Bryan? I have a very large brain. I'm a smart man. I can't watch this shit.
Vinny.
I have a large vocabulary. I'm good at math. I can't watch the show, Bryan.
Well, I'm not good at math.
No.
God! I've been fuming about this for hours. Hours! I can't do it. I can't take this.
I just snorted.
This was a level of stupidity that's inconceivable.
You know why I'm really pissed about it? This is their plan. This is what they wrote it down on paper. It wasn't an ad lib. It wasn't an injury where they had to improvise. This is what they wanted to do.
What do you want me to do about it?
I feel better. So Bam Bam is in fact looking for Flair. It's Bam Bam Bigelow, everyone. If you don't remember, he's 350 pounds. He's bald with flames tattooed in his head. He's a big scary motherfucker. He's going through backstage screaming, roaring, snarling, spitting. You want to fight a girl? You can fight me. He kicks in the door. There's the most terrified woman in this room you've ever seen in your life. I don't blame her. Scott Hall versus Lash LaRue.
Mm-hmm. Okay. This was when we entered the third hour, which for some reason, they went from one-minute matches, like 15 one-minute matches. Now Hall and Lash LaRue has to go like 15 minutes. And they just fucking go on, and Hall is beating him up. They give Lash like one little comeback, and then Hall pins him. And during this match, we have Tony Schiavone saying, Lash really made a name for himself here. And Bobby Heenan says, don't forget the name, people, Lash LaRue. I'm like, are you kidding me? The only fucking guy on the entire show that got pinned clean in the middle of the ring. And we're supposed to think that he made a name for himself in this fucking match?
Why does Russo love this guy?
I'm baffled.
I don't know.
I don't get it.
So
generic?
Like, I'm sure he was trying his best.
Sure,
I don't think
he's
a bad person. He's just so untalented.
He's not very good.
There are many, many guys with more potential than Lash on the show. Now, this is all beside the point, as far as I'm concerned. 20 minutes ago, the SWAT team that was out there to protect Sid from Goldberg stepped aside and let Goldberg hit the ring. The outsiders come to the ring with the exact same SWAT team to protect them from Goldberg. What's wrong with these dipshits? Didn't they see what happened last time? So all the Riot Squad leave except one guy. I'm sure you can all see where this is going. Nash prepares to throw a wizard in his face as he's wearing a Riot helmet with a shield.
Is he going to throw a wizard in his face?
Powder.
Thank you.
You said wizard.
I did. I'm not that smart.
After all that ranting, you realize you're not that smart?
I'm not that smart. The Riot Squad guy has a helmet on. I guess Nash was going to throw the powder into the screen, but it's Goldberg. He tears his helmet off. He spears them both, and that's that. Second round tournament match, Kurt Hennig versus Jeff Jarrett.
I hate this angle.
It's really awful.
The storyline here is that if Kurt Hennig gets pinned, he must retire.
Yeah.
Okay.
He can lose, but he can't get pinned.
Why?
I don't know.
If you don't like the guy, if he loses, he's out of here.
Right. Just fucking fire him.
Thank you.
Don't even wait for him to lose.
This fucking idiot comes out. They do a match. Creative Control beats up Hennig right in front of the referee. They slam him through a table. Hennig is smart enough to just lay there.
Mm-hmm.
He gets counted out. Therefore, he can remain employed.
Creative Control was trying to drag him to push him back.
Yes.
In the ring. Hennig actually grabbed the mat to hold on so he would get counted out.
When it happened live, I actually thought that they were beating him and the ref was just letting them beat him and count him out. I didn't realize, in fact, they were trying to get him into the ring. He was trying to resist going back into the ring. And then when he got counted out, they were frustrated. He was happy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He's happy.
Fuck. In storyline, these writers have given their word and they can't go back on their own stipulation, even though they're complete assholes to everybody. And then Bobby Heenan says, and I quote, "We'll be right back with something. I don't know."
That is a quote.
That is exactly what he said.
That is a quote. Kimberly comes out for a promo. She says, "I'm out here to call out David so everyone can see what he will do to me." Okay. She has witnesses. Good for her. David comes out. It is a trap. Bam Bam jumps in from behind, but David hits a nut shot, hits a crowbar shot. Now Kim must flee through the crowd, and David goes after her.
Yeah, the announcers were here talking about how Kimberly set him up like she's the heel.
I don't know.
She goes to jump the rail. Fans have to help her over. This was so bad.
We go to the parking lot where David is stalking Kimberly. And Kimberly runs to her car and opens it and gets in and tries to drive away. Why didn't you do that hours ago? Why have we been wasting our time with this bullshit when you could have just gone home?
Maybe she didn't have the keys with her in this tiny dress.
Where'd she get the damn keys then?
I don't know.
For that matter, why does she even come to work today if she's this afraid of David Flair? David jumps in the car. He starts breaking the windows of the crowbar. Creative Control says, "Hey!" He runs away. They help her out of the car and take her backstage.
Yeah, I said...
To which point, Bobby, very concerned, says, "She's not used to being in the front seat." You think I'm kidding?
No.
No, you're not.
Your ladder match.
The Creative Control guys grabbed her and said, "He'll see you now."
Yeah.
So they're going to actually go talk to Russo.
Yeah. A ladder match for what I guess is the vacant U.S. title. Between the four guys who have a claim to it, Goldberg, Brett, Sid, and Hall. So they all start fighting even before everyone's in the ring. There's no ref because you recall there's going to be a special referee in this match. So the four dudes are in the ring fighting. Who should come out in a referee shirt with Kevin Nash? But Kevin Nash. He's carrying a ladder. He is accompanied by the Riot Squad, which has turned on people twice tonight.
Yeah.
Everyone on the show is a goddamn moron. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Everyone on the show is a hateable goddamn moron.
The announcers tell us, by the way, the powers that be have signed a big match for Mayhem.
Oh, have they now?
David Flair will be facing Kimberly at WCW Mayhem. They are excited for this match. That's going to be something else, they say.
Why would Kimberly go to Mayhem?
I don't have
Why wouldn't she? I'm sure he was...
She must have a plan.
I guess. I would stay home. I'm sure they have a very lovely...
Let's talk about this awesome finish and get it over with. They're having this stupid match. Bret Hart climbs the ladder. Bret Hart gets the U.S. belt, which I believe he was the champion.
Yeah.
Going into this
technically
match.
Technically, yes.
He grabs it, but Nash, the referee, hits him with a pipe. Maybe Bret drops the belt. Nash grabs the belt.
Were you thinking they were going to make Nash the U.S. champion now?
Yes, of course.
That's what I thought the finish was going to be as well.
Instead, Nash stands up and he holds a belt over his head. And Hall pretends to climb the ladder two rungs. Nash hands him the belt. Hall does an overdramatic fall off the ladder. He wins in a comedy spot.
Uh-huh.
Who assigned Nash?
Oh, to be the ref?
Yes.
I guess the powers that be. I assume.
So anyway, when he grabbed that thing and fell off the second rung of the ladder, like he was falling off the Empire State Building, and that was the finish to this, that was when I concluded this was the worst wrestling show I have ever seen in my
life.
Took
you that long?
So.
Yeah, it actually did, because that was the main event.
It was a fitting finish.
If Benoit and Brett had had a great match and somebody won a title, maybe I wouldn't think that. But that was the final main event right there.
So Scott Hall wins in that matter, as Bryan has described. Tony says, "Scott Hall is now a legitimate U.S. champ." He is?
Yeah.
I want to read. It's brief. I want to read exactly what I wrote here when this is over. "This was one of the worst wrestling shows I ever saw. One of the worst TV shows I ever saw. One of the worst things I've ever seen. Tony calls it an entertaining show and asks what Thunder will be like. Hell," Heenan replies. "Indeed."
Yep. There were 12 matches on that show.
Oh my gosh.
Dude, I should have... The dots on the bar. There's,
yes. Brrr. 57 separate segments.
The average segment on that show lasted...
So 42 times
3. 2.2 minutes per segment.
Wow. I swear to God, this show this tape should be played in the performance center. Like, this should be part of the curriculum.
What not to do.
Actually played to interrogate prisoners.
Fuck, on a loop.
As punishment.
Can you imagine?